In this day and age, with everything online, it's easier and easier to be duped by someone's online presence. Now, it's really important to be able to tell if someone is legit or not online, if they're your competitors so you can tell what it is they're doing right so you can emulate that, or if there's someone that you're thinking about partnering with so that you can tell whether or not you're associating yourself with someone who's worth associating with. Hey, I'm Keith with Hook Media, and today we're going to talk about the things to look for when looking at potential partners and competitors. Now, big disclaimer on all of this, none of these things are absolutes and they vary wildly depending on the field. Every person's scenario is different, but typically, if there are three or four, maybe even two of these red flags, they definitely should be something that you should keep an eye on. It's entirely possible that you have a good company that has a lot of these red flags, but they just haven't had a chance to go ahead and get them changed. And that's actually where we step in. Now, a lot of the things I'm going to be showing you today are actually tips, tricks, and tools that we use when evaluating a business's online presence. So the first and easiest thing that you can do actually is just Google them. See what comes up. What are the first couple things that come up? Because likely, you're not the only person Googling them. And if you're looking to make an association with their brand, it's important for you to know what they're associated with because those people will then become affiliated with you. Go through the first couple articles. What do you find? Click a couple links. See what you see. Yelp reviews are also really important, and look at the good ones as well as the bad ones. If you're looking for an edge on your competitor, the bad ones will tell you exactly what it is that you need to focus on to go ahead and get that edge. And it'll give you a lead to follow up with to maybe check out your product or your service over your competitor. An unhappy customer is definitely looking for alternatives. Next, look at their website. If they don't have one, that's typically a red flag, but not always. If they do have one, does it make sense? Are you able to tell what it is that they do from the first 5 seconds that you land on it? Does what's represented on their website align with who they are as a company? Is the website optimized for conversions? If it's a competitor's website and it's not optimized for conversions, that's somewhere you can get an edge over them. Remember, a conversion isn't necessarily a sale. It's just getting something from the interaction. It could be an email. It could be getting them to watch a video. They could even be just getting the visitor tagged by the Facebook pixel. When developing a digital presence, you don't want anything to be extraneous. Everything costs either time, effort, or money, or a combination of the three. If something is being put out there that isn't getting a return, that's a waste of one of those three resources, and in the case of a competitor, that's somewhere you could get an advantage. In the case of a potential partner, that's something to keep in mind. The next thing to look at is going to be their socials. Now, there's a really big misconception with regards to social media, and it has to do with the following size. Following size matters, yes, but what matters more is engagement. Oftentimes, you'll see people who have really large followings, but they'll get maybe 1, 2, 3 likes on any post or video that they're posting. That means that most of their following is actually fake, which doesn't do anyone any good. There are some tools that you can use to analyze some competitors or some potential partners' socials online. The first one I'm going to talk about is Social Blade. Social Blade is phenomenal for analyzing multiple different social medias. Now, one thing to keep in mind with Social Blade is that it's based on past experience. If someone hasn't been searched in Social Blade before, it hasn't had time to develop a database on them, so it might not be able to give you any of the information that you need. The next tool that's really, really solid, and this one is specifically for TikTok and for Instagram, is called Ninjalytics. Both Social Blade and Ninjalytics are free. I use them often, and they're phenomenal. Now, here are a couple tips specifically for Instagram that could help you out in other platforms. The first has to do with an account's following size. Typically, if they are following more than about 2,000 people, that means that they've probably been using bots in the past, which means that they've probably been trying to inflate their numbers, as opposed to developing the content and engaging with their audience in the way that they should be. The next thing that's a really big telltale sign is the engagement rate. Typically, it's a ratio of likes on a post to followers. Now, if you have less than a 1% engagement rate, that's extremely low, even for accounts of over 1 million followers, and that typically means that they probably have a lot of bot followers. That's something to be aware of. Now, something to keep in mind with engagement rates is that they vary depending on the size of the account. Typically, the smaller the account, the larger the engagement rate should be. The larger the account, the smaller the engagement rate will probably be. Roughly 3 to 7% engagement rate is pretty good. And anything higher than that, especially on Instagram right now, is going to be really, really good. Now on to general tips. Are they leaving any comments unanswered? This is something to keep in mind because if a business is leaving comments unanswered, that means they're not taking the time to engage with their audience and their customers, which is something that in the case of a partner, you should be aware of. In the case of a competitor, you can capitalize on. Look at the kinds of comments that they're getting on their profiles when you're looking through. Are they things where people are actually genuinely interested in what they're saying? Are people strongly disliking that company? Is it just a bunch of emojis? Keep that in mind. Also, look at the kind of content that they're producing. Is it relevant? Is it helpful? Does it actually engage their ideal target audience? For Instagram specifically, also, look at who's tagging these accounts. You should be able to see who's tagging these larger accounts when you're looking through them and scan through some of the posts. Are they positive? Are they negative? That should tell you what you need to know to capitalize on that market if it's a competitor. Another general thing to be aware of is, are they using all of the different features of that platform? If they're not and they're a competitor, that's an edge that you could get. And probably one of the last things that I would look at is the frequency of content production. If it's on a platform like Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, any platform like that, at least once a day minimum. If it's something like YouTube, at least once a week, ideally, although YouTube is a little bit more fuzzy. Now remember, if your competitor isn't doing any of these are some things that you could go ahead and take advantage of to go ahead and try and steal some of that market share out from under them. If these are things that a potential partner of yours is or isn't doing, that's something to be aware of. Now remember, this isn't black and white. Use your own discretion. Every situation is different. If a number of these different things are being done or not done, I would definitely be wary of that situation. Anyway, I hope you liked today's video. If you did, go ahead and leave that thumbs up. Subscribe if you so choose. I would really appreciate it. And share this with someone if you think they would enjoy it or get some value out of it. Anyway, catch you in the next one. Peace.